kelas Van Rossen sekarang. Kita skip dulu beberapa pertanyaan untuk setelah kelas memaparkan materi ya untuk Pak Teddy and Annette. So please welcome kelas Van Rossen. Now is your session to present your topic. Potato tuber moth in control in Indonesia. So please welcome and the floor is yours. You will
Thank
present
you.
Your screen, right? You will present.
Yes.
Your, okay. Yeah.
I please. Will share the screen.
Yes. Please.
Yes. Thank you all for giving me this opportunity. To presenting my research on the potato tuber moth in East Java. It's of course a huge problem in some parts of the world. This project started when Ken Hoes say faced problems in their seed potato store, I think somewhere in 2016, 2017. And there was a huge explosion of caterpillars and damage. At that time, Huub Schepers already did some inventorization together with Ken Hosei. I came in, I was visited in 2019, and that was also my last visit due to Corona, of course. On this place, I want to thank Maries Elemans of the Dutch Potato Organization for his pictures he has sent to me. If anyone needs nice pictures of potato pests or other insects related to potatoes, you should contact Maries. He has a huge collection. Let's see. How can I? Yes. First, something about the potato moth. This is a female tuber moth. The female is definitely recognizable on the black wasp on the back of the body. On the right, the male. Eggs are particularly laid around the nerves of the leaves, at the bottom of the leaves. Very small larvae are hatching from those eggs. Very mobile larvae, they can really move for many meters all over the place. This is some damage in the potato leaf. And these are the green caterpillars. And after they have three stages, and after that, they will pass into an pupae. This was a field vase, but you have also in the stores, you have the same cycle, which can happen, the same pattern. Eggs are found in the crevices of the potatoes. Larvae are white due to the white potato flesh they eat. That's mainly the color of what it is. The damage in the potatoes, and as well at the end, you have a final stage of the larvae and pupae again. This is a bit about the life cycle. It all can happen in 1 month when the temperature and when the conditions are very good. The objectives of the this project was to look at the problem in East Java and looking if there are any tools we can use against this pest. Of course, with a sustainable character, as most synthetic insecticides will be phasing out. And there was also some research done on a biological product, and we have been looking if that was suitable for introduction. But anyway, any biological product which you use against potato moth in the field or in the store, you definitely have to look also after all any kinds of practical tools, because only with biologicals it will not work. Now, based on literature, we went into the field with Ken Jose. We've been looking at the problem. We've been looking for the right moments to control this path in the field as well as in the storage. For the field production, I will show you here a model how it can be working, sort of a guide. Monitoring, which is already done by Ken Jose in the field as well on the damaged plants. And they also used traps. And normally, in an ideal situation, you want to know the threshold. The threshold to decide by instance, an insecticide product. Particularly the threshold also, because you want to prevent that natural enemies will be destroyed as well. And there is really potential in Asia if it concerns natural enemies, because there are many of them. But in general, in the fields we have visited, once a week there was sprayed, but not really against potato tuber moth, but mainly against aphids and trips sometimes. And of course, you have to consider that when you are monitoring on potato tuber moths, because that affects, of course, already, of that can affect already the potato tuber moths population. Next to monitoring in the field, there's also from literature, there are all kinds of integrated pest management tools, like deeper planting. That's a tool which is generally recommended. The deeper you plant your potatoes, or you higher you make your ridge size, there's less chance that the moth larvae will enter the tubers. Irrigation is a very well-known tool against this pest, but irrigation we've discussed, and it is in East Java, that is not really a practical tool. Harvest and storage, I will discuss later. We have been to the field, and together with a buddy and Raka and Adi and Fowlers of Ken Jose, during daytime, but also at late at night, because this PTM is active late at night or in the evening. And we have been searching, we have been visiting 6 fields in August 2019. A very good moment, because if you expect any PTM problems, then it is that moment when it is dry and not many rain. And we have been looking for eggs, damage, potato moths. But really, in the field, we did not found many. It was very low. The population density was low. So the pressure as well. The conclusions from the field visits were that insecticide strategy of the Ken Jose farmers are quite sufficient. So they already spray against other insect pests. And some way this may have lowered the IPM, PTM density. Or is PTM best density in the field?
Yeah, sorry, Ignacio, you have 5 more minutes.
5 more minutes, okay.
Yes.
And of course, what is the effect of the natural enemies? We don't know. We have been visiting some fields on new fields for the first or for the second time used for growing. So it is very difficult to say something about pest pressure and the impact of natural enemies. Well, the natural enemies we found, lady beetles, that was the story of one farmer. He didn't recognize it as beneficial, but he even sprayed to that. So I think there is really a need to get more knowledge to the farmers about these beneficials. Here you see a picture with aphids, with eggs of the hoverfly, and the eggs will hatch of the hoverfly, and they can, and the larvae from those hoverflies can eat complete aphid colonies from a leaf. So there is really some potential using this more. In the IPM control strategy, you can also use, they're still used conventional products, but here I show you something products which have possibilities for integrated pest management introduction. Azadirachtin, as well as Bacillus thuringiensis. They are effective against PTM, and they are very well usable against PTM. In the fields also, lots of other hosts for PTM. So rotation might be some way help to reduce the peak densities. And on the left, you see a nightshade. It was found very often, but I never saw any larvae of PTM or any damage of PTM on these plants. So this may say something about the pest pressure in the East Java area we have been. So in the field, it may not really be a problem. The problem might be much more around harvest and storage. In New Zealand, you also see that around harvest that you can face problems. They usually store their potatoes a bit longer in the soil to keep them fresh for fresh seeding, and that causes some PTM damage occasionally. In the United States as well, they can have PTM problems in the field as well, but they are in the stores. It is very well regulated when they are storing it in a cooled situation. Here, this is the moment of harvest. The ritzes were quite good at Ken Jose potato farms. We have checked 150 eggs. Potatoes on eggs and larvae, and we didn't find any, even not the green potato. So this is really indicating that in the field, it's not really a problem, or it is controlled already. So the focus should be on the store. Can I have my final sheet?
Yes, please. 1 minute, please.
Okay. Okay. Well, at the moment, the current stage is situation is quite stable. Our recommendation is looking for selective insecticides and stimulating natural enemies to make it step by step more sustainable. The main issue is, of course, you do not want to have a high density of pests. You want to prevent that. That is first, but of course, you can step by step work on the situation in the field. But in the harvest and at the storage, it is most essential. Quick and clean harvest, sanitation attention, netting is working in Tanzania quite well. Cooling, of course. I remember that Ken Jose is working on a cooling store. That might help this problem very well. And in the same time, selective insecticides you may use quite good. Population dynamics in East Java is not really understood, I guess, and that may get some more attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Klaus, for your presentation. So yes, we actually we have a lot of questions, but thank you, Hai, to help us in answer the question. Ya, saudara-saudara sekalian, jadi beberapa pertanyaan sudah dibantu dijawab oleh Pak Haid, sehingga silakan dicek jawabannya. Dan saya hanya memilih satu pertanyaan saja untuk kelas. So kelas, I just selected one question for you from Adam Deski. The question is, what is the best practice to manage pest resistance of potato in the Netherlands?
Yeah. In the Netherlands, we do not really have a problem with PTM. We do not have a problem because it is still too cold there. In the south of Europe, you have some problems with PTM, but the storing units are cool enough, preventing any development during storage. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for your answer, Klaus. So I think we have no more time for this session. So thank you very much, Annette, Pak Teddy, and Klaus for your presentation and your answer this afternoon. Dan sebelum ke sesi presentasi selanjutnya, saya akan membacakan tiga poin penting dari sesi pertama presentasi kita sore hari ini. Yang pertama, produksi benih kentang memerlukan standar operasional prosedur atau protokol yang ketat, sehingga kita perlu diperhatikan tahap-tahapan atau fase kritis dalam memproduksi benih kentang. Penerapan protokol yang baik dapat menghasilkan benih kentang yang berkualitas. Kemudian yang kedua, menghasilkan benih kentang berkualitas merupakan suatu tantangan. Namun ada peluang yang besar dalam tantangan tersebut. Pasar masih terbuka lebar, kemudian produktivitas di Indonesia per hektar masih rendah, sehingga itu menjadi challenge kita dan menjadi peluang kita untuk bagaimana bisa memproduksi benih kentang yang berkualitas. Kemudian yang ketiga adalah potato tuber moth atau penggerak umbi kentang merupakan hama yang cepat sekali menginfeksi kentang, terutama yang di gudang, sehingga diperlukan sortasi ulang ketika memang sudah ada potato tuber moth di gudang tersebut dan harus disanitasi ulang gudangnya. Dan tentunya disarankan juga tadi oleh kelas di akhir presentasinya kalau bisa menggunakan gudang yang tembus cahaya ya, dengan perlindungan screen sehingga ngengat daripada penggerek batang atau penggerek umbi kentang ini tidak bisa masuk ke dalam area penyimpanan. Demikian sesi presentasi pertama pada sore hari ini. Terima kasih atas partisipasi rekan-rekan sekalian dan mohon maaf apabila banyak kekeliruan atau kekurangan dari kami. Sebelum kita beranjak ke sesi berikutnya, kami ingin mengundang seluruh panelis untuk berfoto bersama. Mohon untuk bisa mengaktifkan kamera untuk seluruh panelis dan speakers. So I would like to invite the speakers and panelists, all the panelists, to turn on the cameras. We have take a picture together session. Please turn on your camera for all panelists. Yeah, Pak Edwin, mungkin bisa join juga, Pak Kur, Bu Fitri, Pak Tessa, Pak Hermanto, Pak Nikardi.
Sudah?
Oh, ya. Baik, kita akan ambil foto dua kali. We will take a picture, for two picture. Yes, the first picture, keep a smile. One, two, three. Then one more, please. One, two, three. Okay, thank you very much for our panelists, for your time and your participation, and for the speakers also. Dan selanjutnya, untuk di sesi Presentasi yang kedua akan dipandu oleh kolega kami dari PT Kentang Tulando Sejahtera, yaitu Bapak Abdullah Hadiansyah. Beliau adalah General Manager dari PT Kenhose. Kepada Bapak Abdullah Hadiansyah, saya persilakan untuk melanjutkan sesi presentasi yang kedua. Silakan Pak Abdullah.